Good morning, East Ridge. So glad that you are here with us this morning, that we can worship the Lord together. I hope you're ready. We're going to sing some songs and praise Jesus together. So let's do that together right now. Who am I?
Who am I that the highest King would welcome? I was a lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, it's free. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am in my Father. This hope, gave everything to save the world you love. And this hope is an anchor for my soul. Our God will stand unshakable. Presence, Lord.
welcome here. Together one more time. Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come find this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be
Good morning, Eastridge family. Thanks so much for tuning in, for joining us today. I pray that you're sensing the presence of God in your life today, that you are experiencing His blessing in your life, and that today, as you open your heart to His Word, that He will challenge you yet again to the things that He's called us to be. And today we're going to continue in our series, the One Another series, really looking at the blueprint that, God has given us in His Word of how we are to live in community together, caring for one another, encouraging one another, loving one another, bearing with one another, stirring up one another. And today we're going to just really open our hearts and, ask God to challenge us again to be the community that He has called us, designed us, created us to be. Amen. Would you pray with me? Let's ask God to just speak to us powerfully through His Word today. God, we thank You again today. We thank You that You speak. We thank You that You are alive. We thank You that You have a plan and a design and a purpose for our lives as individuals and for us as a community. God, today as we open our hearts to Your Word, I pray, God, that You would truly deposit powerful seeds that will bring fruit and fruit that will last. God, we recognize that as we evaluate how we're doing as a church family, as a community, God, that there are some things that we can certainly do better. And I pray today, God, that You would really speak to us. God, that You would open our hearts and minds, Lord, to see the areas that You have called us to, the things that You have designed us for. God, point out the things that are lacking in us. Show us the areas that we need to grow in and do better with so that we can better reflect You, Your purposes, Your compassion, Your heart for what it means to live in community. God, I pray that You would help us be a stronger, more faithful, more true community and reflection of You to the world around us so that they too would come to know who You are as they observe our lives and we welcome them into Your family. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, today we're going to be talking again about the one another's found in Scripture. We're going to talk about three of them in particular, found in Romans chapter 12. There's actually four found in Romans chapter 12. We're going to kind of focus in on three found between verses 10 and 16. I'm actually going to read most of chapter 12. So if you've got a Bible that you want to follow along with me in, you can turn there now to Romans chapter 12. We're going to be talking about being devoted to one another in brotherly love. We're going to be talking about honoring one another above ourselves. And we're going to be talking about living in harmony with one another today. Romans chapter 12, starting with verse 1, it says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all that He has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that He will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship Him. Do not copy the behaviors and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." That is my prayer. Just as Paul desired to see it happen in the church in Rome, my desire is that it would happen in us as a church here in Addis, that we would invite God to change the way we think, transform our mind, transform our thinking, and that as He does that, that we would learn what His good and pleasing and perfect will is for our lives and for our church. Amen. He continues on. He says, "Because of the privilege and the authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Do not think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith that God has given us. Just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body and we all belong to each other." We all belong to each other. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in just a moment because that's one of those one another statements, not one we're going to focus too much on, but it's important for us to understand the foundation of a belonging to each other, belonging to the same body. Verse 6, "In His grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others, then serve them well. If you are a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it is giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take that responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift of showing kindness to others, do it gladly. So we see that God gives different gifts and that we all have different callings and passions, and we are to do those things just as God has given us the ability to do them. Verse 9, do not just pretend to love others, really love them. Whew. Man, I know that there's a whole lot of pretending going on in the world today. In fact, I know that there's oftentimes pretending that goes on in the church. And Paul is calling out the church in Rome saying, hey, stop pretending. Really love each other. Really love one another. Hate what is wrong. Hold tight to what is good. And then reading from a different translation, verses 10 through 16, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. There are more one another's in this chapter, Romans chapter 12, than there are in any other portion of scripture in the New Testament. Four of them to be exact. The first one found in verse 5 that I mentioned I was going to reference again, which calls us to be together as members one of another. In one translation, it actually refers to the body of Christ. It refers first to our body. We know our bodies have many parts. They all have specific function. And it is the same in the body of Christ. We as the church are the body of Christ, and we have many members, but we all belong to one body. And it says that we are members one of another. That's that all alone, that's that one another statement and challenge, and it calls us to understand that we belong to one another. We are never intended, God never purposed for us to live isolated outside of community, but rather to belong to one another. And when we begin to understand that, then we begin to recognize that we don't just do what feels right to me, what's good for me, what benefits me, but rather I am a part of this body of Christ, and I want the body of Christ to be fulfilling God's design and purposes, and I've got to do my part in order for that to happen. I'm not going to spend too much more time on that, but I wanted you to hear it this morning. And then moving right into the three one another statements that we're going to focus on today, which are devotion to one another and brotherly love, honoring one another above ourselves, and living in harmony with one another. Verse 10 has two of those one another challenges. The first one, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. That word brotherly love there in the Greek is actually, it's a phileo love. It's Philadelphia. Philadelphia is the city of brotherly love, right? That's that Greek word that speaks of this love, this connection. And I don't want to spend too much time on this one because I'm going to actually do another message in a couple of weeks around this loving one another, because that love is the glue that holds it all together. But this reference is a brotherly love. And I know obviously because of the way that it's translated into English as brotherly love, we think of a love that a brother would have for another brother. But actually, what is meant by this phileo love is actually better defined when you consider the love between a mother and her child, a child and their mother. And it's a familial love, and God has called us together to be a family. Now, I know that you were born into a family. You have a biological family, but Paul wants the church in Rome and for us to understand that when we accept Christ, when we are born into the kingdom, when we're born again into faith, and we take Christ at his word, and we believe who he is, we are adopted into the family of God. Paul, at the very foundation of what he wants the church in Rome to know and to understand and to apply to their lives and to their community, is that you've got to see each other as brothers and sisters in Christ. In fact, he starts out chapter 12 that way. I read it to you in the New Living Translation. Let me just reference it from another translation. It says, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices and holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." And oftentimes we focus on living our lives, giving our bodies as a pleasing sacrifice to God, living sacrifice. And we skip right over the fact that Paul, in the opening verse of this chapter, he says, listen, brothers and sisters, right? He's trying to beat this drum of we've got to recognize each other as family. We are an extended spiritual family for one another. Listen, I know that some of you have great biological families, and you may think, well, I don't really need that because I have that. But the reality is this. There's another verse in Scripture that says that Christ is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. How many of you know that sometimes, you know, our biological families have challenges and issues? And to be honest with you, there's oftentimes dysfunction in our biological families. And what Paul is calling us to, not that we're perfect at it. I mean, let's be honest. The spiritual family that we belong to oftentimes can be just as dysfunctional as our biological family, but that's not the way God intended it to be. He actually calls us through these one another challenges and statements to actually rise above the way that we see families treating each other. And he calls us to be a better, stronger, more unified family than perhaps what we see as an example in the world as a biological family. And my prayer for us is that we would be that. And this is not in any way to diminish the family interactions that you have with your biological family. My prayer for that is that you would find great harmony and unity in that biological family as well. But as a spiritual family, Paul calls us to a high standard of how we are to live together. And I want us to recognize that as an extended family of God, that Paul wants us to recognize that this is fundamental. This is absolutely fundamental to the way that community is supposed to happen. That we would see each other with this family love, with this bond that a mother would have with her child, and that we would adopt that kind of love into our community. That we would be devoted to. I love that word devoted, this devotion. It's a strong commitment to one another. Why? Because we're a family. We belong to one another. Verse 10, the latter part of verse 10 goes on. It says, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. And then the second one another challenge is honor one another above yourselves. How many of you know that we're pretty good about honoring ourselves and making sure that we get honor for the things that we do well. But this is saying, hey, honor others above yourself. Paul is teaching the believers in Rome that as a spiritual family, this is how we do it. If we're going to be a spiritual family, we've got to learn to honor one another above ourselves. You know, we honor in our lives, we all honor what has value to us. If you have something in your home that is irreplaceable, you will treat it with special honor. You will protect it. You will care for it. You'll make sure it's got a special place and that it gets the treatment that is needed, right? And that's because of the value that it has in your life. Or maybe you would even say, this is invaluable. It cannot be replaced. And so therefore, it receives special honor. What I love about this is that in a free market economy, value is determined by what somebody is willing to pay for any given thing, right? So the value of something is based on what someone else would be willing to give for that thing. And the amazing part about this is as we now transfer that idea of value to our lives, we recognize that Jesus gave his life on the cross. He laid down his life to set your value. In other words, Jesus set the value of your life so high that he could never be outbid. He laid down his perfect life as a sacrifice for you and for me. No one can ever give or pay a higher price for your life. Your life is of value to God. But what that also means is the person that you like the least in our church family or in the body of Christ, the person that you like the least, they also are a life that God has given His Son, that Jesus laid down His life for. They are of value to God. If we can begin to look at each other that way, we may not like everybody, we may not agree with everybody. There may be people that rub us the wrong way, but if we can learn to look at them through the lens that God says, listen, I value them. I have a plan and a purpose and a design for their lives, and I have put them in community with you. And so if I can value them, then you can value them. When we begin to see them of great value, how many of you know it will change the way we treat one another? It will change the way we interact with one another. And so Paul says, listen, I want you to honor one another above yourselves. I think that we need more honor in our world. I think that this is one of those things that needs a lot of growth in the world, in the church, in our own lives. I think that we can all do better at learning to honor one another. I think the reason that so often in our lives, in our world, the reason that people so often feel the need to pump themselves up, boost themselves up, or share how great things are, part of the reason that we share only the highlight reel on social media is because we're trying to prop ourselves up and trying to bring honor to ourselves, trying to get people to think that things are good in our lives. But what would happen if we would start honoring one another more often? I really think that if there was a lot more honor, if we would learn this principle and incorporate it into our lives, that we wouldn't have to keep propping ourselves up and showing everybody how good things are. We could start being ourselves. We could start living the way God designed and created us to live without having to bring honor and glory to ourselves because others are doing that on our behalf for us, saying, hey, man, I see God's purposes. I see them being fulfilled. Man, I'm so proud of you. Well done. Good job. We start honoring one another, especially where honor is due. I think that it changes the dynamics of society and our lives and our interaction with people. And I just think that there needs to be more honor in our world today. And I want to invite you to help me. We're challenged as people of God, as part of the body of Christ, we are challenged to cultivate this culture of honor. And I want to invite you to help me, especially in our church, to cultivate that culture, to honor one another above ourselves. You know, there's a lot of material here in the next couple of verses. There is be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. He talks about sharing with those in need. So be generous, be hospitable, practice hospitality. He talks about blessing one another and not cursing. He talks about how we're supposed to rejoice with those rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. And quite honestly, there's an entire series of messages right there. And I'm going to encourage you to interact and discuss some of those things as you get together in your community groups this next week. I hope you're in a community group. That's part of why we're talking about community, so that you can understand and step into, be a part of community as God designed it to be. But for the sake of time today, I'm going to just move right on to verse 16, where we read the last one another challenge, and it is to live in harmony with one another. You know, I wonder how our Heavenly Father's heart breaks, how it must break when He sees His children fighting over things that just really don't matter, fighting over petty issues. I really think that it breaks the heart of God, because we see in Scripture, throughout Scripture, His encouragement to live in unity together with one another, right? And I just think that these things that sneak in and cause division and strife and fighting in the church, I think that God's heart must just break over the fighting that He sees in His church and among His body. And I want you to recognize that There is a very real battle that is being waged every day, that there is an enemy of our soul, that the devil wants to steal, to kill, and to destroy, that he wants to tear down your life. He wants to distract or to discourage or to divide you from the plans and purposes that God has designed you for. And I think that oftentimes within the church, the problem is we're so busy fighting against one another that we don't have the energy or the capacity to fight the spiritual battle that's going on. How devastating that is when that happens. I think the enemy looks for an opportune moment to come in and just hammer us and to come against us. And oftentimes we don't have the strength, we don't have the energy to fight back against the enemy, against the schemes of the enemy, because we're too busy fighting with each other. You know, harmony, when we think about harmony, which, by the way, this if you look at the original Greek, it's not actually the word harmony. It actually is a reference to having the same mind together with one another. But most translations actually use the word harmony because they translate the idea, the concept that is being communicated in the original Greek. And what Paul was saying here is a reference to harmony. And of course, I'm not a musician. I'm not skilled in music. I don't have a great understanding of music. Perhaps Shea could actually speak to this a lot better than I can. But the reality is this: when we think about harmony with one another, it doesn't mean that we all have to think the same way. It doesn't mean that we all have to have the same passions that the others each other have. But rather, the idea of harmony, when you think about it in musical terms, is a combination of different notes working together with one another to create a complementary sound that is beautiful. Let me just read that again. That's not my own words. I stole this off the internet, but it's harmony is this idea of a combination of different notes or musical notes working together with one another, creating complementary sounds that are beautiful. And I believe that this idea, this concept, is fitting to what Paul was trying to say. When we work together as a body, belonging to one another, encouraging, bearing with, stirring up, strengthening, all these one another challenges, that what God's intention was is that we would work together to create a complementary, unified sound that would be beautiful to God and to the world around us. I don't have time to talk about all of the gifts that we referenced in chapter 12, that Paul references in chapter 12. But you remember, I read it. He said, listen, if you've been given a gift, then use it. Do it well. Teach well. Encourage well. And he encourages us to recognize our gifts and to use those gifts. Why? Because as we use those gifts together for the purposes of God, then God can make something beautiful of his church. Rather than us arguing and fighting and bickering and, you know, being concerned and divided over our differing opinions, our differing passions, I want to just remind you again that you don't have to be passionate about the same things that I'm passionate about, and vice versa. I don't need to be passionate about all the things that you are passionate about. God puts those things in our hearts. He stirs up passion in us. He stirs up gifts in us. My job is to be who God has created me to be. Your job is to be who God has created you to be. And that together we complement each other and we create something beautiful that neither one of us could create on our own. That's what community is all about. As we live out this design purpose that God has given us in his word, to live together in community with one another, we actually become stronger and better together, as I've said so many times. You know, in conclusion today, I want to just draw us back to verse 1 again. Because in verse 1, Paul says, "Dear brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy." I think that's a powerful start to this chapter as Paul is giving these challenges. In view of God's mercy. And I was reminded of a worship song by Hillsong. The title is From the Inside Out. And the first part of the lyrics of that song, it says, "A thousand times I have failed, still your mercy remains. And should I stumble again, I'm caught in your grace." You know, I think that the key to all of these one another challenges, to bearing with one another, to forgiving one another, to stirring one another up, to encouraging one another, honoring one another, being devoted to one another in brotherly love, and on the list goes. The key to these one another statements, I really believe, is understanding the mercy that God has shown to us. Let me say that again. The key to living out these one another statements is truly understanding God's mercy and how He has bestowed that mercy upon us. You know, as we think about the cross of Jesus, the ground is level at the cross of Jesus. There's not any one of us that, based on our own merits, based on our own well-doing or being a good person, none of us are going to earn the grace, earn the mercy that has come to us. It's all there, not because of what we have done, but because of what He has done. And I want to just encourage you today to lean into, to be reminded of the mercy of God on our lives, because I believe that as we recognize our dependence on that mercy, our dependence on the grace of God in our lives, it levels the playing field. And now we can start to treat one another the way that we understand God has treated us. We didn't deserve it. We didn't earn it. Oftentimes in life, we want to make people earn our respect, our honor. That is not what God has called us to. In fact, He said, "Listen, I laid down my life for you. While you were still a sinner, Christ died for you." And God has come to give us this grace, not because of anything we've done, but because He loves us. So in view of God's mercy, how will we choose to live? I think that the question today is, what lens are you looking through? What lens are you looking through when you view and see the people around you in your community, in your church family? Because the lens that you look through will affect the perspective that you have on those people. And Paul is calling us to look through the lens of God's mercy on our lives. Paul exhorts us, look through the lens of God's mercy. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before Him endured the cross." Why? Because He loves you. Because He wanted to redeem your life. He had mercy on you. He had mercy on me. If we begin to see through that lens of God's mercy the people around us, it will change the way we view ourselves. It will change the way we view others. It will change the way we treat and engage with one another. How do we keep God's mercy in view? Well, we go back to the foot of the cross. We kneel there. We kneel right there, and we call on God to have mercy on us again. God, help me to see and to treat others in view of Your mercy on my life. Would you pray with me today? God, we are all sinners saved by Your mercy and Your grace. God, today we acknowledge and we recognize our dependency on You and on that mercy and grace. God, we couldn't do anything to earn Your favor. You gave it freely when Jesus laid down His life on our behalf. God, we recognize today that if left to ourselves, we will mess this thing up. In fact, we already did mess it up. And yet, we're not left to ourselves. Your Word tells us, promises, as we looked at in the previous weeks, that You promised to never leave us nor forsake us. You paid the ultimate price, and You came alongside us when we had nothing to stand on. You picked us up out of our sin, out of our brokenness, and You began to redeem and restore and bring us back into right relationship with You. And so God, just as Paul prayed a couple of chapters later in Romans chapter 15, I pray this over us today, over our church today. May the God who gives this patience and encouragement help us to live in complete harmony with one another, as is fitting for followers of Jesus. And then, God, we will be able together with one voice to give praise and glory to you, God, our Father. God, I pray that over our church family. God, would you be lifted up? God, would you be glorified? I pray, God, that you would give us patience. You would give us encouragement. God, that you would help us to live in harmony. God, harmony is not easy. Even as I think about the challenge of making harmony musically and how much effort and practice that takes. God, we know that to live in harmony, it's going to take effort and hard work and lots of practice, and we're not going to always get it right. But God, would you give us the patience and the endurance and the encouragement we need to live in harmony with one another? God, I desire for Eastridge Church Addis, with one voice, together with one voice as one body, to glorify you, to bring glory to you. God, to expand your kingdom in our neighborhoods and in our city, in our nation and beyond. God, that you be lifted up, that you be glorified through the way we love, care, bear with, encourage one another. God, help us to do this in such a beautiful way that people would see the goodness, see the love among us, and that they too would come to glorify you. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. I love you so much. I pray that God's blessings on your life, and that we'll see you real soon. Have a great week.